Good evening and welcome to Brookfield's Old Town Hall. My name is Laura Rocha. I'm the library director here. And we're the hosting organization for this event. Special thanks to Curtis Corin, whose web of connections and enthusiasm really helped organize this program. And thanks to the folks at the Old Town Hall who have allowed us to use this space free of charge. If you're so inclined, feel free to donate to the donation box as you leave. Donations help fund the Old Town Hall's ongoing renovation and refurbishment and upkeep, and allow us to have a community center. Tonight, we have a panel of journalists representing a variety of local and regional and even national publications and news outlets. They have quite a variety of expertise, interests, scope, and experience. And we will listen as they discuss issues and concerns related to the fast-changing media landscape. Hopefully, it's not all about money, but it might well be. In short, at the table, we've got Tim Pellegrino, who's editor-in-chief of the Herald of Randolph, and Marty Frank, editor-in-chief of Valley News, Tom Powers, who's authored several books and been a contributor to The Atlantic and New York Review of Books and other publications. We can probably tell you more about that. Christopher Wren, who is a former foreign correspondent for The New York Times, currently recently released a book on Ethan Allen. And Katie Jickling, a Brookfield native. And this panel is Anne Galloway, founder and editor of Vermont Digger. What a panel, huh? Thank you all for coming, and please hold your questions. We'll have a Q&A at the end.
Yes, thank you very much, Laura, and thank you everyone for joining us tonight. We decided to go without microphones, so if you can't hear us, give us a signal and we'll talk a little louder. We're just going to start talking generally about the state of the news industry, which, as many of you know, is in kind of a sad condition. Commercial media is, in any case. But I wonder if we could all start with a question about the audience, about readers. What do we think people want from the news media? And I'm going to start with Tim because he says he has half a brain cell left. He just put out the Randolph today.
This is one of the tougher questions on this list. I think we know what we wish people wanted, what we hope they want. What they actually want is a difficult thing to decipher sometimes, I think. I think we hope that they want to know what important things are going on in their own communities. And I think to some extent that is the case, but I don't know that I have a better answer for that one, honestly.
And I mean, just to follow up, Tim, why? Why do you think it's hard to understand what people want? What do you perceive that they want? What are they doing instead of reading news?
That's a great question. I mean, to some extent, I see this sort of with volunteer fire departments as well. We see a lot of fire departments who are desperate for personnel to participate in their organization. And this is kind of coincided with many more options for ways to spend your time. I think that while volunteering for a fire department or reading your local news are important endeavors, there's also admittedly an element of entertainment to these things. I mean, if your options for things to do when you're not working are somewhat limited, then your desire to participate in all these other things, like volunteering, like reading your newspaper, are an easier choice to make than watching Netflix until you fall asleep. That's kind of a bummer way to start out, but anyway.
Okay, well, let's go downhill from there. Who else wants to chime in?
For me, the essence of news is telling people something they don't know. Mm-hmm. And for me, the challenge of putting out a newspaper in recent years is figuring out what people don't know. My newspaper has both national and local news, and I know our readers appreciate the mix that we offer them. And when it comes to choosing which national news to provide, it's hard for me as an editor to figure out where in the news cycle we're going to be. So when our paper comes out the next morning, do our readers necessarily want the breaking news that they might have already seen on their phone? Do they want analysis or something in between? And I often, that's something I struggle with more and more.
How do you make that decision in the end?
I just guess.
You just guess.
And part of the problem, of course, is that not all of our readers are the same.
Yeah.
So there are certain, for the most part, I lean more towards respecting the fact that we're not delivering breaking news anymore, at least when it comes to national news. So I'm talking about what goes on the front page for the most part. So I lean more and more towards analysis or second-day pieces as much as I can. But there is some national and international news that's so consequential that you can't ignore the fact that the newspaper needs to recognize its importance by putting it on the front.
I think a lot about capturing attention and to what degree are we responsible for doing that, for capturing people's attention, and I don't know if anybody else worries about that or if anyone wants to comment on the way the internet has impacted our business and the 24/7 news cycle and how we deal with that, how we dive into this mass of information and distinguish ourselves as local and even national outlets. How do we capture people's attention long enough to help them understand what's going on?
Well, I'll hazard a comment on that. I think it's always very dangerous to start by asking, what do they want? Mm-hmm. It's not that they don't want things, but they want changeable things that come and go. And the publications that spend the most time actually really seriously trying to find out what people want hold focus groups, mm-hmm. and they almost invariably find that what people want on the whole, numerically, are the shorter things, the easier things, the less disturbing and troubling things. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's a way of deciding what isn't the most important. And there are a lot of publications that go about doing that. The most interesting papers are ones where the people who run it spend a lot of time thinking about what ought to be in the paper. Mm-hmm. And a good paper always has a very lively struggle over that question, and sometimes more, sometimes less. Mm-hmm. One of the things I discovered a few years ago, I was working on a book about the Indian Wars in the 1870s, and I spent a lot of time in Wyoming and Montana and places like that, and I read all the local papers. And one of the papers I read was the Cheyenne Leader in Wyoming. And the Cheyenne Leader in the 1870s was terrific. It was full of interesting stuff. The people were ambitious writers. They did all kinds of color stories. They seriously grappled with real issues and problems. And the Cheyenne Leader today cannot bring itself to put an actual story on the front page. It's all about local high school football teams and other sporting events. The people that run the paper aren't really very, who own the paper, aren't really very interested in what's in it. Mm-hmm. And I think there are a lot of areas of journalism where that's generally the case. I think a lot of local television stations have all decided that if you just do crime, it's very easy because you know exactly where to go to get the info. Mm-hmm. And there's always something to get a picture of in the course of the day. And it doesn't cost much to do, and people do watch it. They turn it on and watch it. So I would listen to any reader that wanted to volunteer what they'd like to hear about, but I wouldn't urge people putting out publications to concentrate on that. Give them what's important. Give them, you have your own idea. you're a Vermont digger. Mm-hmm. And that defines your attitude towards the state right off. Mm-hmm. And people will show up because they instinctively understand what it is you're trying to do.
I think that one thing that's really interesting or different, I think, about working for 7 days is the publishers have basically chosen to cast a really wide net and get as many readers as you can. And sometimes people will come up to me and say, oh, I love your I Spies, or like your personals. Oh my goodness, like, do you know how long I just spent writing like the news? And so sometimes like I kind of roll my eyes at that, but I think often that's a question that all organizations are grappling with is how many people do we want to capture in some way? Because probably the people who are reading the personals or turning first to the personals are not going to be reading the news regardless. And so to capture that breadth keeps the rest of us in business and it engages the community in different ways versus catering to what is primarily, I mean, more and more the people who are reading the news are white and liberal and wealthy across nationally. Those are sort of the statistics. And so grappling with the extent, you know, how much of that substantive news we want to put forward on a regular basis, I think, is both a business question as well.
Well, I mean, I'm personally of the persuasion that people don't know what they want to say to give it to them. I mean, I realize there's a little bit of arrogance in that, but I think that at the end of the day, society works when we have experts, when we have people who are doing nothing but creating news and studying the news, or plumbing, or teaching, and you know, these all things all require expertise. And in the news business, it requires a certain amount of expertise to know how to ask the right question at the right time. It takes a lot of psychology. You have to know how to place a public records request, how to fight for those records. And you have to know what's happening in the world around you, and it's complicated. I mean, when I left the office today, we had, you know, Colin Miner, editor, said, wow, it's a major trash day. You know, we had a decision that came down from the EPA on PFOA. Don't ask me what happened. All I know is there was a decision. I didn't have time to get into it. You know, then we had a story about the FDA pulling back on the added sugar rule for maple syrup. We have a story about a police officer who's been accused of wrongdoing in Chittenden County. We had the usual, sorry folks, nonsense in the legislature over this fight over the budget and taxes and the governor's office. So that was happening all day today. Colin and Xander were chasing that. So by the time I left, and there were 4 or 5 other stories that we were working on in the queue, and you know, we were having a hard time deciding, okay, what goes? Like, those decisions are actually made in the moment. You know, we're trying to figure out what's most important each day. And sometimes those are longer term projects we're working on that might take a week or 2 weeks to finish, or you know, you've got to get the new, you know, the sort of event style news out that day. So it really is tough to make these decisions, but I think the way that people decide that they want to read is they vote, you know, with their clicks. And so, you know, I think the reason why people read Digger is because we are serious about our news, and you know, we now have a lot. We have 244,000 readers a month, and that surprises me, frankly. I mean, because we don't do anything entertaining, really. Probably should do something entertaining once in a while, but we don't. And so I think, I actually think I'm a contrarian, but, you know, I do understand that people want really short stories on the web, and that we should write in 3-paragraph pieces, but, you know, I've published 9,000 words on the web. You know, I think that people will stop reading when they feel like stopping reading, and it's our job to just put the information out there and let people decide from there, but I don't know. Chris, what do you think?
As I'm thinking, I think I agree with everything that's been said. But can I just step back for a bit on this and talk about the elephant in the room, which is Donald Trump. What I want to say is that we're also in an era where there is what's called fake news.
Right. Yeah.
And fake news is what the President of the United States declares to be fake news. And I think this is the problem that you have to, you know, when people are reading, and I think the future of journalism lies in very heavily in local news. But I also think that we're getting, we're in a constant battle with the likes of Donald Trump to try to make news credible and keep news credible, because and I can talk about this later too, in terms of what is fake news and what is really fake news.
Well, we can talk about that now. Yeah. Keep going.
Well, let me give you an example. I went back and looked up some things. The buzzword is fake news, and everything, and because we get such an onslaught of this today, fake news is actually dates back to colonial times. And let me give you an example. Here's something that was said. In the British reaction from the British. They pay little regard to facts, but the contents of it are as replete with deceit and falsehood as most of their publications. Now, what was the context of that? The British reaction to the first draft of the Declaration of Independence. So, and when I worked in Russia, I worked 4.5 years there, and I was expelled, threatened with expulsion. Your words are not those of a Soviet journalist. And the whole notion of disinformation, Russians have a word for it. This infects the whole progress. I think the area where we can hopefully, I'd like to see if we can keep it, the level later is the future of the local news. But the local news is fighting a hard battle in terms of having people give it the credibility that it deserves or needs. And Trump's attacks and perils on fake news create one big fat advertisement for the value of basic journalism. But we can't afford to give it away for free, and that's the problem. Readership is up, digital circulation is up, competition, as I look for what Trump called the New York Times and the Washington Post. What has saved us is what's coming out of the White House, that people will go online to read this. When I worked for the New York Times, one of my jobs was in the laying out the front page and working on the front page for the paper. And we had a circulation, which was very good, of 1.1 million copies. And on a good weekend, we go up to 1.7 million copies. Now, that's no longer possible. The circulation of the New York Times is now 3.7 million, which is like triple what it was, but it's all digital. Most of it is digital. And so I subscribe digitally, and then I buy the Sunday paper, but I don't need to. And first, digital does not encompass local news. It should, because I think what's going to save us is local news. But I think that if we try to... I think we have to deal with the reality of the Trump era. I can give you an example if you want, or I can do it later. Mm-hmm.
Well, why don't we talk a little bit about this issue, about trust in the news and fake news, and then sort of that?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay, that would be great. Yeah, Tim.
Can I just kind of... brought to mind the thing that Marty said about people are looking for something that they don't know yet. Mm-hmm. And I sort of find myself wondering from time to time, to what extent is that really true versus to what extent are people looking for things that reaffirm what they already know? Mm-hmm. I see that, mm-hmm. you know, with trying to think of what the, what's the name of the conservative website news that's been around for a little, the Watchdog, is that what it is? Vermont
Watchdog
or something?
Oh, yeah, they don't exist anymore, but yeah.
Oh, really?
Yeah, they left finally.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
But we see these little things propping up all over the place that are reporting news from a very specific viewpoint that is, you know, custom designed to tailor to what people want to, you know, want reaffirmation that what they think is really true. Again, this is one of those things I don't know the answer to, but I think it's worth thinking about as we go through this.
Well, I think you want to, there's a continuum that I think is important to point out. Fake news is actually utter falsehood, right? Mm-hmm. A story that's completely false. That's fake news. So, you know, with the troll farms in Russia and in Eastern Europe, you had people basically making things up and pretending that was news, and it was spreading on Facebook and people believed it. And that's one extreme. And then when you talk to people about trust in news, they'll also say, well, you know, if I click on sponsored content, that's fake news. Or if I read a story that has factual inaccuracy, that's fake news. Or something that Trump disagrees with, that's fake news. It's become sort of catch-all. And I think that what people need to understand about journalism is that reporters make mistakes, editors make mistakes. And so there's a difference between making a good faith effort to get it right and making a mistake and completely fake news. So it can be, I think, difficult for people to discern the difference with a big bucket, you know.
And there's a particularly, I mean, subtle and pernicious version of that too, which is just cherry picking the facts that fit the narrative that you've picked out ahead of time.
Well, and that's what you were getting at, is the partisanship. Yeah. So if you have a partisan news outlet that isn't giving you the whole story without a flavor, that's problematic, right? Because you're not presenting the whole truth as, you know, as best as one can present it without a point of view. Yeah, so actually I was in Maine yesterday, and I found out that there are two very popular blogs in Maine. I don't remember the names of the two blogs, but apparently one is very right-wing and the other is very left-wing. And there's really not much in the middle for the state of Maine. And when I found out about that, I thought, wow, that's a travesty for the state. Because it's really hard to claw back, you know, to watchdog.org, which Tim referred to, was run by the Franklin Institute, which is funded by the Koch brothers, and it was basically a state-by-state effort to cover legislatures across the country. And it failed in Vermont, I don't know why. But these things exist, and they can be very confusing for the public and for readers. Yeah.
I want to say, let me, if I can just go back. And first, I have to say, is that when I look at what newspapers can do, I look at the Valley News. Mm-hmm. It is terrific. Mm-hmm. And you look at the work they put, they have good people, they work on a shoestring, I think, and they try to, and they build up this. Mm-hmm. But when, it has a credibility. Now, it has a credibility that everybody lives in the Upper Valley. But I think they are very good about making sure they check their facts. I've been written. They got it right. And I think that's important, because you have to have somebody to do that. The question is, how long can you afford to do that? The New York Times has been through this, where we had to cut back a lot of good sections. We had to shrink it, and how far can you shrink it? One thing that occurs to me is the price of newsprint. You're all looking at the problems of that. And this really binds people when the administration puts who doesn't like Canada anyway, puts a tax or puts on Newsweek, a tariff on newsprint. It doesn't affect them, but this hurts all print. And then, because print is a vehicle, then it also hurts digital. Mm-hmm. If you understand what I'm saying, and I think this is the problem. You know, when we had, part of it, now the news cycle, you've learned, you know about the news cycle. It was a cycle of news, a weekly news. And when I was working, when I left the Times, I worked over in Central Asia and mostly Russia. to train journalists, and we dealt with this whole thing of trying to cut out a paper and getting, they had no, what I was talking about was totally foreign. And it sat with them, and they said, oh, we could do that. And then they got involved and was doing first-grade journalism. I mean, I've helped a number of papers, got three good papers going. Putin closed them all down. He came and he trashed everybody. Some people went to jail. But I think there was an effort. People, journalists want to do the right thing. They want to do it. But they're fighting all these pressures on every side. I'm just going to finish my thought on this, but when I talk about using social media to control the news cycle. We had a news cycle. We'd get the stories in, and you had to meet a deadline and everything. Now what happens is it's news cycles in journalism by Twitter. It's tweets. The tweets control what goes in to the national or the international coverage. And how do you do this? You start, when I was there, the whole logic was that you had a news cycle, you conceived of the sharks swimming around in the pool. And at noon, the zookeeper would throw a piece of meat in there and they'd sort of tear it all up. And then it was settled, and that was that sort of cycle. Now it's every day that happens. And it's done by tweet, where Trump tweets something out, and it's at 6 o'clock in the morning, and it's preemptive framing. He's the first to frame an idea, whether it's right or wrong. It gets out there, and then it echoes back and forth, where people pick up on it. Today, when the national or even some local, they see what Trump's, he controls that. So he frames the news preemptively, and you have to work against that. The other thing he does is to divert. He diverts attention. We're having this now where he says, well, he didn't really mean to separate children from their parents. And, I mean, after that thing went crazy. He tries to divert the attention from real issues. And he says, well, this is lying Hillary's fault. And he's got these labels on people. So, and the other is he deflects. When something comes out, he attacks the messenger. Saying, and that's by framing what the story about him as fake news. And the other is a trial balloon, which we did. You have a story and you put it, you send something up and see if anybody wants to grab it. And the governments or diplomats always get this, and then you look whether you're going to cover it. And if that's up there, so Trump sends with these dry balloons, and usually somebody for Fox News grabs it and runs with it, and it's not really a story. So this is a legitimate problem.
It is a legitimate problem, no question about it. What do we do about it? Tom, do you have some thoughts about it?
I certainly can't tell you what to do about it. There are a couple of things you can think about it. The first thing to keep in mind when we're talking about Trump, and Trump is the big fact in American political life at the moment. We've never had a guy like that running the United States. And for quite a while, we didn't think it was possible to happen, and he didn't either. I mean, the first couple of hours after he was elected, he could hardly believe it, and he was almost paralyzed. He was very slow to get moving, but no longer slow to get moving. He has a personality with a deep instinct for how to control a discussion and to remain perpetually the center of attention and to make every issue always around him. If you go back to the founding of the country and the writing of the Constitution, one of the things that the Founding Fathers were obsessed by was the possibility of demagogues taking over the country. And they constructed a government that they thought would provide the checks and balances that would make that impossible. But we never had anybody with this native genius for that. The curious thing is that it exists completely without any actual interest in politics or world affairs or anything of that kind. I've never seen a sign that he's actually interested in anything except himself and zoning regs in New Jersey. That's it. So when we're dealing with the Trump problem, with the Trump challenge, it's really unique. And it's very tough for news organizations to know what to do about it because of his skill in dominating these conversations. And the fact that he does have the bully pulpit and he has the loudest megaphone. However, there are things that are working to undermine that. And they are basically the real world. And a lot of the things he does skirt on the edge of real danger. His tariffs and economic plan is skirting on the edge of real economic trouble. And his dealing with Iran and North Korea is right on the edge of real serious military trouble. And Trump can't solve that. You know, once something like that gets out of control, reality will begin to exercise checks upon him that our arguments in public cannot succeed in doing. So it seems to me that when we're talking about Trump, we're talking about one thing, which is kind of unique in history. And when we're talking about the news business in general, we're talking about something that overlaps with that, but is not that.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think that sometimes when we talk about, enter into this conversation, the discussion around local news is fundamentally different in terms of credibility. There's a Harvard sociologist who became pretty famous with a paper in the 90s called Bowling Alone, Robert Putnam. And he followed it up with a couple books too, but talks about the decline of social capital and that fewer people are in Elks clubs and going to church and more people are bowling, but fewer people are in bowling leagues. And so you see this decline of civic engagement and in community and that structure. And he ties that directly to newspapers, and newspapers are included in that discussion. And so when you have newspapers that then build up the community, and then the community builds up the newspaper, and in that cycle, you have growing trust in each other and in the news, and growing civic engagement. And so a lot of the time we talk about newspapers as sort of separate from that, but I think it's a broader discussion about what's happening in American communities and how both the news responds, but also how we interact with the people, with readers, essentially.
It's an interesting point, and it raises a question that I have for Anne, even though she's supposed to be posing the questions to us. And I'm wondering if, as a former newspaper reporter and current editor of a digital news site, do you feel a different relationship with your readers now than you did working for a print publication? Is it a more remote relationship? Because is absolutely crucial to what we do.
Well, you know, it's funny. When I worked at the newspaper, I was a Gretel and Times artist for about 10 years before I started digging. And I always felt somewhat remote from readers of the paper. Hmm. Because we, you know, had someone at the door who was checking people in when they came in. We had administrative assistants answering the phone. You know, I answer the phone with Digger. We have someone who picks up the phone now, but, you know, he comes in immediately with, Florencio comes in immediately with the pink slip to tell me I've got a call, you know, and I think the reason I feel so close to them is because when I started Digger, every reader was precious. And, you know, people, I still try every day, even though I get something now like 400 emails a day, I try to go to pick through and respond directly to readers. Who have questions about our stories. But what makes me feel particularly close to readers is that they hold us accountable every day. You know, I think people hold us to a really high standard, and if we have typos, if we have errors, if people criticize us all day long for everything we do. And you could see that as a problem. I don't. I feel like responding to that and allowing the readers to weigh in on how we report and what we report on and, you know, the mistakes we make, it holds us accountable and increases our closeness to our readership. And in fact, we have this little form at the bottom of every story. It's a submit a tip, report an error, and then a submit a document form. And we get three or four tips that way almost every day. And then we also, people email us, they call us, they feel like they can turn to us for help. And that makes me really proud of the work we do. We, unfortunately, we can't always respond to every request to report on something, but ironically, I mean, you think that like the web is sort of like the Wizard of Oz, right? You've got this web screen up, nobody, you know, I think sometimes think people think, well, you know, who's behind that web page, right? It feels really distant, but it could feel that way, but in our shop it doesn't. Like, it's really, and we go to an effort to try to put our pictures up on it. You know, we have a picture of the reporter at the bottom of every story, along with their bio, mostly because we want people to see that we're human beings, you know, that we're there working on the website. And so we try to be really ultra-responsive to readers and in fact, to sort of counteract that that feeling sometimes people can have distance, you know, with websites. We have our address on there, we have a phone number on there, our email addresses are on there, my cell phone is on there, I get random calls all the time. And, you know, so, I don't know, what do you think? You have a website now, do you feel like you're closer to your readers through the newspaper part of the news organization, or how does it work for you?
Well, it's hard. It's hard for me to tell because when our readers are unhappy with us or our readers have a suggestion or want to respond to something we've done,
yeah.
It's almost indistinguishable for me.
Yeah.
And it's, in fact, irrelevant whether they're responding to our website or to our, you know,
right.
Our
yeah.
newspaper.
It is irrelevant.
And there isn't, there is some difference, but there's not a lot of difference.
Well, that's great. I mean, I think it comes down to customer service. I mean, we really are a service industry.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Well, I think local news is basically news you can use, which I think is important. I think that one of the problems we've had now is people are happy to pontificate and write not in the news, the letters are letters. The notion that people are willing to participate, there's a lot of people who give you their opinion, but how many people will actually go out and do the shoe leather and give you the facts and then build what you're doing from facts? And it's very easy sometimes to just assume that, I teach a journalism course at Dartmouth for college in my training, and the students want to stand up and write opinion pieces, and I said no, I want the facts. If you can't justify everything that's in there, then I don't want to hear it. And I think this is the whole kind of thinking that still is relevant to local news in a way that it isn't for a larger audience.
Could I mention something, just getting back to the credibility component, and you mentioned the getting corrections from readers, and I have to say that's always been one of my favorite sections in a newspaper, and I love that we do that as an industry. I love that, you know, we acknowledge that, yes, we're people, we make mistakes, and let us tell you exactly how we made a mistake and then set the record straight. Yeah. I think that's one of the most positive things that newspapers honestly do, and I think that's really important to, as a way of communicating our credibility to the audience.
Yeah, I can agree with that. We haven't talked much about the business model, and you know, the reason why in Vermont, you know, we've lost, I was talking to Jim Welch about this the other day. He's the former executive editor of the Burlington Free Press, who we hired to help us at Digger with projects, and he and I were trying to figure out how, you know, what the losses have been in media in Vermont, and we think it's between 60 and 75% of journalists and newsrooms and the dailies have gone MIA. So Burlington Free Press, Rutland Herald, and Times Argus, the three big daily papers. And you know, nationwide, we've lost 50% of the journalists. We used to have 40,000 journalists, we now have 20,000. And that's because there's been a big shift in the advertising model. And if you look, there are charts that show that, you know, advertising in newspapers was always really profitable. People made 18% a year in the old days on newspaper. That's what the profit margin was on average. So people made really good money year over year on newspapers. But then things went south when the internet came into being, and Google and Facebook started realizing that they could make money on advertising. And since that's happened, we've seen a complete reversal. So newspapers are going down like this, and Google and Facebook are going up like this with advertising. And you know, it's affected local papers a lot, and certainly the Times. Although I was at a conference last week, and someone from the Times, Kenzie Wilson, who started the Daily podcast at the Times with some folks there, is now at WordPress, and he was saying that about 50% of the revenues for the Times now come from readers, from subscriptions, which is a huge thing. And you know, so the business model has completely changed, and I wondered if Marty and Tim and anybody else who wants to jump in on that, wants to talk about that, and where we can stand.
Well, last week my paper announced that we are making a number of substantial changes. We are one of the last full broadsheets around, and sometime over in the next year, we are going to stop printing our paper. We're building a new press that we will share with a sister paper in Concord Monitor. And our newspaper will be printed there. And our newspaper will be narrower. It will be what the Times and the Globe is now. So we will be, and we're also outsourcing our ad production. So the people who can compose the ads are going to lose their jobs. The business model right now for daily newspapers is to, rather than look for new revenue, is to cut expenses to see what kind of a newsroom they can afford. The Valley News has been extremely fortunate over the last 10, 15 years, in that we've been affected much less than the Rutland Herald and the Burlington Free Press, but in the last couple of years, we're really starting to feel it. And my newsroom is not what it was just a year ago. I have one less photographer, about two or three fewer reporters, a graphic artist we used to have is no longer with us. So that does two things. You have fewer resources to gather and write the news. And the other thing that isn't talked about enough, and something I feel acutely as the editor of the newspaper, is people are working too hard. I'm really concerned about how sustainable the newspaper industry is with the workforce it has. So it's not a very optimistic message, I realize, but more so than in any time in my history in newspapering, I'm feeling it right now.
It's really.
I haven't thought about that. When newspapers first began, they sold for a penny or two pennies on the streets of London. And they were paid for entirely by the readers. And slowly, advertising began to creep in, but it was a long time before advertising took over the newspaper. People bought the paper. And one of the things that hasn't happened in the growth of journalism on the internet is we haven't found a way to get people to pay for it. Mm-hmm. So, and the internet is a very easy medium in which to start a publication. I mean, the amount of overhead that's required is extremely low. But to raise the funds you need by advertising or by trying to get readers to contribute is very cumbersome and very difficult, and it doesn't move quickly, and it's completely undependable. So I do feel, without having a specific suggestion about how to go about it, that digital publications need to find a way to get paid for what they're offering people. Very, very simply. It should be as easy as the easy pass that you put on your car and go through toll stations. It's just a click, and it's done.
You get a penalty, though, if you don't pay.
Well, mail your bill.
Maybe you can do that, too.
They give your email to Donald Trump.
I mean, just to echo what Marty said, I think there's a lot of pain in our industry, I think, because those of us who've survived, those of us who are left, I think feel a really intense obligation to the public. And we love our jobs and we love what we do. And I do think that Marty's right, the people are working in my shop way too hard. I mean, you know, I don't know when Colin Lyon's going to leave the office for me. He started at 9, could be 10. You know, those are the kinds of days that we're all putting in. And you can't do that forever. It's really true. Right. When you're running it daily, that's really the reality. Because you've got the fire hose at your face all the time. So.
Well, there's also the question of where the next generation of reporters and editors are going to come from. Thank God we have people like Katie who we still have some young people coming into the
industry. But it's going to be just Katie.
What's that? Yeah, that's why I always have fought to get Katie on her podcast.
I've been counting on her to buy the film.
We started bidding more on Katie before we came.
Yeah, right.
But the Valley News has a really good writers. It's a writer's paper, I think, in many ways.
We're fortunate to have some very talented people on our staff.
But it's true, I don't know if you've seen this, but it's hard to find mid-career professionals. You know, when we put an ad out at Digger for a reporter or for an editor, it tends to be people at either end of the career path. It's people right out of college, or it's people who are retired or on the verge of retiring. Mm-hmm. Are you finding that too?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
When you can find people.
When you can find people at all. Yeah. Because people who just left the profession in droves. Yeah. There's just not, you can't make a living at it. It's actually good. It's like, we're going further and further down the hill.
Can I jump
in? Can you say something positive?
I'll say something positive.
Okay.
Unsolicited.
Okay.
I definitely wanted to say this, but another way in which Vermont newspapers and New Hampshire newspapers, for that matter, have suffered is that with the decline of daily newspapers and weeklies, and the Associated Press has really struggled. Mm-hmm. And the Associated Press used to be absolutely essential to all of us to get our state news, which is as important to our readers as our local news. And in Vermont, I'm not sure what would happen in terms of getting Vermonters the information they need if we didn't have Vermont Digger, to tell you the truth. Vermont Digger has done a wonderful job stepping into that breach and making sure the State House is covered. And if you're not supporting Vermont Digger now, I urge you all to do that. And I was not asked to say that.
To put in another plug, you mentioned the loss of jobs at the Free Press and the Times Argus, and a lot of those people have ended up at Vermont Digger, at least for a while.
We're a good so refugee camp.
We're all grateful.
I think it's been you know, so wonderful that we've been able to develop these collaborative relationships with you guys, because it's really about working together. And, you know, thank God for the Valley News. We run your stories all the time. And we would not be able to help people around the state understand what's happening in the Upper Valley without your intent. So, you know, I think that's where we're coming together with resources and trying to collaborate in a competitive environment for the betterment of, you know, readers. And that's where I hope it's all going to go. Like, I think we should all be working together. So, Katie, talk to your boss about taking
a in the midst of all the doom and gloom, I think that it obviously has been a challenge for established newspapers, but at the same time, or established news media, but at the same time, there's like this sort of incredible democratization of news with the internet. And in some ways, I think you could argue that readers aren't necessarily worse off. I was just brainstorming some of the things that have popped up in the last few years. Like Erica Heilman's Rebel Strip Vermont. There are a couple of podcasts out in Burlington, or one's called Brown and Out, like highlighting non-white, non-binary or queer people. There are some, the Montpelier Bridge just became a nonprofit. There's UV Daily in the Upper Valley, which is mostly online. Front Porch Forum, a lot of people are getting their news there. And so it allows regular citizens or people who you know, want to work at journalism to jump in and do it in a lot of ways, in a way that has the potential to be really effective.
But on the other hand, there are whole regions that are not being covered adequately.
Yeah, and some of them are really bad, right? So I don't know what they're doing, and are,
yeah.
So there's that risk too. But
yeah,
I'm prejudiced, but I also I'm not a huge fan of publications online or otherwise that don't have editors.
Yeah.
And I think there's a number of problems that come with some of these sites that are run on citizen journalism, which is not to say that we don't benefit from them in many ways, but there are a lot of problems with them too.
Even with professional reporters, I think, I mean, having an editor look at something and say, hey, did you think about this? You made this assumption in this story, and there might be two ways of thinking about that. And I think that's hugely valuable, whether it's citizen journalism or professional journalism.
Or somebody's reputation is at stake, or you want to be careful with the facts, because facts can very much affect people.
Yeah.
The New York Times has cut back. They had, you know, they're being squeezed too. So one of the things they decided to do, which we all thought was a great mistake, is to eliminate the editors in the middle. We had something like backfield editor, where you'd plan what you're putting in the paper and everything, which I was, and when I wasn't out in the field. And then you had these copy editors who checked everything. And when I was working, filing out a really far away places, I'd file a story, and, you know, and you did it by any way you can to get it out. You know, we're writing up rocks and chisels just to nail them down. And you always felt that there was an editor who would say, well, that's not right. And you had that. They stripped that away to save money. They decided to incorporate it into one person. And the one person, and so we now had one, even now we have this one layer of editors. And the mistakes immediately just soared, because there is nobody there to check it. And there's on Facebook, they have it's a closed site for New York Times alumni. And I read it, because all the things that go wrong, you can catch it there. And people were complaining. They had a thing, but, you know, when they were talking about Guam and Kim Jong-un saying his rockets could hit Guam, and nobody thought of running a map. In the old days, you'd have a map, here's where Guam is, and nobody knew who Guam is. So we sent a message. They circulated, where is Guam? Where did they hide Guam? And the site, you know, just met. magazine, so they had to find a map of Guam. Well, it's very important to know where Guam is if Kim Jong-un is going to fire a missile. But this is the problem where the lack of oversight, there isn't enough money to do the editing that needs to be done. So reporters have to be their own editors, and that can be treacherous, especially since some reporters don't like to admit they made a mistake. If it's digital and you made a mistake, then you just go in and just zip, it never happened.
So should we have entertain some questions from the audience, or does anybody have any questions for the editors? Yes, sir.
Yeah, I have a question for you as the moderator. When papers rely on advertisers, it was always that worry that if you have really big advertisers, you know, that you could, you know, self-monitor what you print because you're afraid of offending, you know, a particular advertising. But with your model, you really mostly rely on donations. Mm-hmm. Do you have a similar kind of problem where you worry about who's giving you money and how the news might affect the kind of donations you get?
Well, I can't worry about that. And I don't let my staff worry about it. In fact, recently we had a series of stories about the basin of the F-35 in Burlington. And we had a big donor who was very upset about the series. And I had a back and forth with them, and I tried to explain, you know, we were trying to be fair to all sides, and he didn't like that, and I don't expect he'll ever give us money again, and that's okay, you know, because at the end of the day, we have to be true to our readers. We don't write for one person who's giving us money. We write for readers in Vermont. And that series of stories had a big impact. There were three city council votes in which residents had pressured the city councils to reject the basin, and they went that way instead of agreeing with the congressional delegation and the mayor and Governor Phil Scott that, you know, the fighter jets should be based there. People are worried about the sound and the impact on human health, especially children. And it's incumbent on us to lay all that out regardless of whether people like it or not. You know, I mean, if I had to worry about being liked, I wouldn't be able to get up in the morning. You know, I mean, it's kind of fun because I think that at the end of the day, we're all just trying to understand the world around us. And if we can keep an open mind and try to gather as much information as we can about things in our communities, then, you know, maybe we can learn something and we can build some consensus as a community and as a society. One of the things that bothers me sometimes, we'll print a story and we'll have many sides in that story, and someone will write to us and they'll say, you only should have told this side of the story. And that's not the way it works. You know, we want people to come together and understand different perspectives, because maybe you haven't thought of it that way before. And maybe if you thought of it in the way your neighbor did, it would color your thinking a little bit, and you'd have a more nuanced point of view. Yeah, I firmly believe that we can disagree and still get along. And we can actually point out things that aren't good, and we can disagree with our leaders, and we can hold our leaders accountable, and make Vermont a better place. I know it's completely naive and idealistic, but I really, truly believe that. And my people believe that. I think a lot of people think that journalists are cynical. And that's actually not true. Journalists are really idealistic people. I mean, you know, I'm always shocked when someone lies to me. And it happens all the time. You think I'd be used to it by now? I used to not only be shocked, but I also used to take offense because I was dumb about it. And then I realized, you know, we all do this. It's just the human condition, right? I mean, there are people you want to protect, you love, and you're connected to, you don't want to see get hurt, or, you know, there are things that you just don't want people to know, or You know, there are all kinds of reasons why people don't tell you the truth. They don't fess up. And that's the fun of it for a journalist, because you begin to read the signs. You know when people are lying to you. And then you're like, aha, there's a great story there. You have to see it as a gift. You know, so anyway, how did I get off on this roof? any other questions?
Well, what you just said about just wishing you gave this person or that person's perspective reminds me of a dark day in some towns, including Randolph, when they went to Australian ballot.
Yeah.
You no longer had to listen to your neighbors.
That's right.
You know, it was a topic you might have thought you had a strong opinion on, and you know, you're listening to the other points of view, and you're convinced that you were missing a lot of information, and now you can come in with your opinion and vote the way you think. And that whole layer is gone, and it's so that's why people value media, because you will see the other sides that you do not understand unless you hear them all.
Well, I served on the school board once. it was a really interesting experience. This was before I became a journalist. It was for 3 or 4 years. And I loved it because I go into a school meeting, I hear something, you know, I get the agenda and I think about what we're going to talk about. And I go into it with a very definite opinion. And by the time I left the school board meeting, what I thought was so beautiful about it is we all came into meetings with our opinions. And then by the end of the meeting, we had come to a consensus. We didn't have divided words and votes. We hashed it out. And at the end of the meeting, 9 times out of 10, we voted unanimously on something that in the beginning, we just didn't, it was a problem to solve. Like, we were all like, holy shit, how are we gonna solve this? And then is the beauty of many minds around the table coming together to solve the problem. That's where we need to go, you know, somehow, as a society. We've kind of lost that. So I agree with you, Australian ballots back. Let's bring back the town meeting.
I just interject one thing. When I started as a journalist, crusty editor gave me 2 rules. If your mother says she loves you, check it out. And if you want a friend, get a dog. And I always think about those. It's nice to be friends with everything, but you know, when the chips are down, you got to get the facts out there.
Absolutely. Any questions? Yeah.
Katie, I'm not sure how much you know about this, but give a shot. Your publication is a little bit unusual in that it distributes largely free and obviously gets a lot of advertising. Do you think that model is going to continue to work in the next decade? It seems amazingly successful. We just heard some bad news about the Valley News. All papers, but you know.
Yeah, I think that. So the two publishers started, Pamela and Paula, started about 23 years ago now, and have really sort of worked hard. I think there are a few things they've done well. I think developing roots in the community and building that trust, and so and also. Creating a diversified funding stream so that we do a lot of things that a lot of newspapers don't do. Like, we have events, we just have the 7 Daisies, which, like, you'd be astonished how much, like, hate mail, like, how much people get jazzed up about this, like, voting comment. It's really absurd. It's great. Things like the personals, things like, specialty publications for the airport and for tourists and French speakers and college students, and there are 7 different publications. We just launched a Super Readers program, which is basically like a voluntary subscription, right? It's for profit, so it's not sort of the same as Anne's model, say. But I think that sort of hedges your bets a little bit, and that I think that advertising is fine at this point, but if that changes and if more people are moving toward Facebook locally, or if, you know, a whole bunch of chain stores come in and don't want to be paying to advertise in the local paper, then there are other options. And so I think
those creative approaches at this point. There are a lot of people that, you know, we don't know what works. We don't know how to pay for it online. But cast your net wide, I guess.
You know, you talked about, or some of you talked about how the style of the president kind of sucks the way people respond to the news, but I'm curious if you look for those who are, you know, for writing for your publications, how, if you step back and really try to look, how did it influence how your publication responds to things? And without saying which newspaper this is, I was struck being, noticing how the legislature was covered, the state legislature. One of the publications called it Inside the Golden Bubble. And I responded to that as someone who was really offended by, does everything about the government have to be undermined? Do we have to make a pun or, you know, witty? And I'm not saying that that was the intention, but that was my reaction. And I just wonder, too, how other publications see, like, you know, how have we responded to, you know, the level of, you know, having to cover tweets? So I don't know if that's directed to anyone in particular.
Well, Inside the Golden Bubble is Diggers, just
yeah.
And it does offend some people, but we haven't changed it yet. We might at some point. But we used to call Scope Blog the Supremes. That also generated some reaction.
It's because of the times where I feel everything has to be right or wrong, and it's more, you know, absolutely, it's a personal reaction. It wasn't.
But what do you all think about?
Well, one thing that you notice is different in response to Trump in terms of what newspapers do is newspapers feel much more comfortable labeling a lie a lie. I mean, that could never happen before. Trump forced that upon us. That's one thing that has. It's changed, and I get the sense, especially with the times, that there's a little bit more recognition of the adversarial role that they're playing, because it's almost existential at this point.
Mm-hmm. Well, in terms of the Times and the Washington Post, he has revitalized the news industry. may not have brought any more into it, but people want to know what's happening, and now. Every man and his dog is trying to find that story about that nobody has covered that could reveal what's happening. And you know, when you have, I have one of my favorite, if I find it here, I'll find it later for you. Here it is. Oh, this is, because part of the problem that we have now and nationally is the politics of grievance. Mm-hmm. And I think about Trump at the at the Coast Guard graduation. Last year, telling the graduates, look at the way I've been treated lately, especially in the media. No politician in history, and I say this with great certainty, has been treated worse or more unfairly. Well, why can't you grab that and run with it? So we have, it's a funny world where people, where the finances are problematical, but I think Trump, to give him credit, has revitalized the news industry vis-a-vis the New York Times and Washington Post and the Wall Street Journal. They're looking, and McClatchy newspapers, which are small newspapers, is not finding some good stuff, and they're just digging through everything to try to figure out what Trump is up to or what his background is, which as you get into it is kind of sleazy. And I think this, I shouldn't draw a conclusion. Basically,
you said
somewhat. And I think what's happening now is a vigorous, in terms of danger, it's a vigorous news gathering operation. People are looking, turning over rocks, saying, "Where did he say this and that?" Because it's like pining for gold, and a lot of the stuff is there if you just turn over the right rock. And What you need then is something to, so you have that enthusiasm, the whole politics of grievance. And will that sell newspapers? I don't know. People want to know what the next shoe. I think it's kind of. But this is the fact of how it's working now in terms of the national press. And there's some very good reporting. Mm-hmm. And if you look at what's happening with this sad business of taking children away from people crossing the border, that really went viral. And everybody's waiting, and now they're having to worry about it. So you can have an impact what's happening. I would like to, you can't just get a page one story every time or whatever the equivalent of it. But I think to have the press working and looking here, and I think that in the Vermont journalism, you do have the people who are looking at the issue of the jets at Burlington Airport is a very interesting story. Mm-hmm. Because they say they need him for national defense. Do they really need him to put him there? But you know, people live around say, "This is a lot. We've had this, and now you have noise." So I think there are a lot of basic issues that touch people's lives, and you can figure out how to work those. I think there's a future for journalism. The question is, there's sufficient money.
Yes. So I think we're at a very interesting point for a lot of different reasons, but I keep hearing the word newspaper, and I think that in 10 years when all the kids who are on their tablets and their computers and don't read newspapers, I don't think there will be newspapers. There will be journalists and there will be journalism outlets, mm-hmm. And so I feel like, please don't take offense at this, but I feel like the newspapers are the horses and the electronic devices are the motor cars. And I think there is going to be that transition. Mm-hmm. And I think it sounds like one of the limiting factors for online journalism is getting funding because people don't want to pay for anything online. But there's also the fact that, and I will be very general and offensive and say millennials usually just want to do the basics. When John Hershey published Hiroshima in The New Yorker, it took up the entire issue. And so there's, you know, some reality factors, but in terms of having journalism live on, is it the finances that you think are the limiting factor? Is it interesting? Is it the interest in people going into the field? What will keep this incredibly important, service profession, whatever, the country.
Waking up, people waking up in the morning saying, I wonder what happened today. Mm-hmm. I wonder what happened overnight.
But they're still doing that.
Yes, I know. And that's just
what they're saving.
What's that?
They're not paying.
Well, in the New York Times, they do. I pay $45 a month for my digital subscription.
But they're also looking.
It's not enough.
They're also looking for answers on Facebook.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So how do
they're looking for answers from their friends.
So as a kind of journalist, how do you see this going forward?
We don't know.
Thank you.
So I can say that, first of all, I like the term newspaper, and I think it lends some credibility to the profession. There are lots of organizations that call themselves, that say that they do journalism, and some of them I cringe at. I consider Vermont Digger a newspaper.
I call it paper, too.
Yeah. But really, in contemporary times, we've always sort of run two tandem organizations. Mm-hmm. We have a news gathering organization that makes basically no money, mm-hmm. and we have this business operation that we use all the money we make there to fund the news gathering organization. And so, I mean, in all of our memories, that tandem organization has been advertising sales. I think we need to, and I think more and more we're finding other ways, other tandem organizations to ride alongside our news organization. So if it's not advertising, we just have to figure out what's the next thing that will make money for us.
Like what?
There you go. Like, for example, I know the Valley News has done a bunch of like media consulting type of things. Is that reminding you the...
we have attempted to diversify to by doing such things as offering our expertise for a price to websites who advertisers who want to spiff up their websites, so they use expertise in our advertising department to, you know, figure out how to do the websites.
Which I think is a great, you know, I mean, what skills do we already have that we can share with other people to get the same thing done? Until the 90s or so, when the Herald Press closed and we started printing at the Valley News, we had a bunch of other publications that we were printing and designing. So that was another source of revenue that once we closed our press, we lost. But it's not a new thing to have to cobble together different chunks of revenue to fund the news. So we're on the search. If you have ideas, let us know.
I do think that there is hope for the nonprofit model, mostly because of the way people share on the web. And so I hope that it'll work for a while anyway. But I think that it's very difficult with a commercial model online, just because, like I said before, we're talking about trading big advertising dollars, really, for what they call digital dimes. So Google and Facebook charge very small amounts for reaching large audiences. It's really designed for millions of eyeballs, millions of viewers, right? And our small outfits are reaching thousands of readers. And so we can't sell digital advertising at the same rate. Our rates are, Google sells for between $1 and $3 per 1,000 impressions. That's 1,000 views of a web page, website.
$3?
We charge a digger 14 per 1,000, and that's the going rate statewide. WCIX charges the same rate. I'm not sure what 7 days does, but 14 is the going rate. So you really can't compete with Google and Facebook, and that's been the problem. That's why it's been difficult for print newspapers to move to the web. And that's why I think if the end game is we're all going to be on the web, then we're all going to have to rely on readers for support in the way we did before. The good news is that, as I think Tom and Chris pointed out, that's the barrier for entry is much lower. It's not as expensive to be on the web. Print, I mean, at the Times, I was in the Rutland Herald, they spent at least $1 million a year on newsprint. When I was there, that's a lot of money. Digger's budget is $1.5 million. That would be most of our budget, right? So we don't have to use paper. All of our money is spent on people, either raising money for news operation or reporting or editing. So it's a totally different model. You don't have to keep the press maintained. You don't have to deliver the newspaper. You don't have to print the thing. And God knows I loved all that because when I worked there, my favorite thing to do was to run out and grab the paper. Take a look at it, smell it, and everything. But that doesn't exist anymore. I'm sorry, there was a question here. Yeah.
I had a question. Someone mentioned that in the housing days, expect a return of 18%.
Yeah, that's right.
What are they expecting today?
Well, that's a good question. I don't think I don't know what the profits are. I'm not sure there are any profits. I think some for-profit newspapers are essentially operating without profits. And that's why you see a continued decline in the number of positions in newspapers. And people are having to really tighten their belts, and one wonders when there's going to be nothing left in that history. Yes, John?
Well, I have two questions. One is, it's a follow-up to that. Is it that, or is it the owners of those papers are looking at how the returns on investment in other companies are making them a lot more money, and so they're just going to skim off more off the top?
Well, I mean, that's an interesting question because I didn't have time to read the story, but there was a piece recently about how publishers are continuing to make good profits on newspapers as they jettison staff, like the Denver Post. The Denver Post would be, you know, I think we're talking really big newspapers here. The local papers, it's not, the margins are much, much, much tighter for local newspapers. I do think the Free Press, though, was a real cash cow back in the day. And they are getting,
Second question. Well, I have a friend who wonders if the media industry basically is supporting the dominant paradigm, and how would you react to somebody saying that you're supporting the dominant paradigm, which is a, which is you know, pro-growth, unlimited growth on a finite planet type of approach, especially as we enter the heart of the climate crisis. Pretty provocative. I'm sorry. It was just a friend who was asking that.
No one can accuse the newspaper industry these days of unlimited growth.
No, no, no. Supporting the unlimited growth of the capitalist economy. What the question is, not unlimited growth of newspapers.
That's an that's a really interesting question. I've found myself skeptical of unlimited growth as a any positive thing to aspire to, but I'm curious to know how we are supporting that. What's the mechanism you see for that? Except besides, well, we obviously operate in a capitalist economy.
Yeah, we're operating in a capitalist economy.
But I think we all are doing that, not just the newspapers, right?
What's that?
I mean, we're all doing that, though, right? That's not just a media issue.
Sure, but it sort of goes back to the question about, you know, how close you are to your nonprofit donors or your for-profit advertisers. You know, those are the people that are paying the bills, and so. You know, while I understand that there is the two sides of the house, which I think makes a lot of sense, there doesn't appear to be criticism of this dominant capitalistic paradigm.
Gotcha.
And maybe, you know, I mean, we all see what some politicians have to say, including Bernie, about Northern European countries that are more socialist economies. Mm. You know, they're still having an impact on the world, the global economy as well. But anyway,
it's a really interesting idea. I mean, I don't know how everyone else deals with this type of thing, but in general, I feel like our news pages are there to report what's going on, not necessarily to champion one particular method of doing anything at all, really. If you would find something like that, it would be on the editorial page, and I wouldn't be surprised to find that there.
But to compare that, I mean, to follow that, you know, take the dairy crisis in Vermont right now.
Yeah.
Canada's not having it.
Yeah.
And why? And that's just, to me, like, that's another elephant in the room. That would be, I mean, why that is a completely interesting, and I would think that could be covered very thoroughly.
Yep.
And it's a huge reality. Why do Quebec farmers make a living off 40 cow farms?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And so, anyway. So,
yeah, that is a big question. That's actually a story that is somewhat in the works, and there's a lot of divergent opinions on that.
Mm-hmm. Well, so. I think in general, and I take this as criticism of our own publication, I think that we could do a better job of looking outside the state to see what other other states are doing, what Canada is doing to solve problems. And so I think you're right, we could be doing that more. We could be looking at, you know, states that have solved problems too that we haven't addressed yet. If, for example, my understanding is that in Ohio, farmers are required to inject manure in the soil. Here in Vermont, that's not a requirement. Whether it should be or not, another question. But they're doing it differently there, and it would be interesting to go look at that, right? So there are all kinds of things like that that we could be taking a look at. I think in Vermont, we tend to be really insular, and we tend to think that we've figured it all out. And the newspapers are the digital and print newspapers are guilty of doing it too. You know, we tend not to look outside our little worlds to find out whether there are better ways of doing things.
As I think it's being more now.
Yeah, for nationally, I think it is.
Yeah, as you know, a reporter sort of doing this every day, I know that it's very easy to get caught up in like going back to the same sources, or you know, I have a certain quota that I'm basically expected to produce, and I work long hours, and you know, it's easy to fall back into this sort of Rolodex journalism of like, oh, I know these people will call me back, and you know, I don't have Rolodexes anymore, but And so, I mean, one question I'm always trying to like step back and sort of like, okay, so what's going on? What am I missing? And I really like try to put in a lot of time just like meeting for coffee with people off the record that I have never met before to sort of get a broader view. You know, I cover Burlington, so get a broader view of what's going on at the city on the ground level. Like last year, I went like every once a week was my goal for like several months to eat at the Salvation Army for dinner, just to like see what I was missing. I think I ended up writing one story about it. A question I always ask my sources, what did I not ask you? What am I missing here? And a lot of the time we do rely, like we're human too, so we rely on you guys to be saying, why aren't you covering this? Or here's a tip that you may not have seen, or, you know, so.
And I have to say too that on that, I'm always appreciative of sources who are willing to talk, who are willing to be candid, because so many people won't. And especially I'm appreciative of sources who are courageous enough to come out on the record. And you know, so few of us are willing to take a stand on anything now. And it's really depressing as a reporter to interview 5, 6, 7 people who won't come out on the record. And something that's really basic. So, you know, we are a reflection of society in that way.
It's really amazing how that's changed in the course of my career, and it's as frustrating as anything in journalism. Both the reluctance of people to talk on the record, in almost any situation, and the willingness of institutions to try to control people in their institutions in either stopping them from talking or trying to control what they say. That has changed a lot.
It used to be way more open here, and it's just not now.
No, I mean, it would have been shocking 15 years ago for me as a reporter to call a member of the school board and ask him or her for an opinion about an issue before the board, and for the school board member to say, you need to talk to the chair of the board,
right.
The chair speaks for the board. Mm-hmm. I mean, this is an elected official who should be held accountable. But it also goes to talking to non-officials on the street, and I don't know if, you know, the uncivil tone of social media is making people more reluctant to talk. You know, they're afraid of the consequences of speaking out. But even tenured professors at Dartmouth College are more reluctant to speak out these days. And it's a problem.
Sounds like a story.
It's true, I think people are more fearful. I
think I'm going to have a statement here that deal with that polarization. I mean, we have a whole raft of people that don't hear one thing, and another, you know, and I'm going to call them somewhat irrational, and then another side that is more rational.
You think you can?
Yes, and I went out on a limb there. But you know, your rationality drives me crazy, and it must drive journalists nuts. I mean, it's just like you mentioned lying and untruths and that kind of stuff. So I don't want to be negative, but our society is plummeting to the bottom a lot faster than it was 10 years ago.
What would happen if the media ignored Trump's tweets? Just said, got all together and said, we're gonna ignore
him. That'd be horrible.
Wouldn't that be horrible? Yeah. I mean, you could all have a pact and said, we're just gonna see it and let it slide by. It would be beautiful.
As I've argued to a member of my household who has made that same argument, it's really hard to ignore the President of the United States.
It is.
It's really hard.
But he doesn't have anything to say.
That's the point.
That's the point.
You have to ignore him because he has adopted as his best friend this dictator from North Korea. Now, that's something I think will then, you know, should attract our attention.
It's Sundays off. It's
favorite. No, he has to be helping.
Do we have one more question?
Yes. Oh, we talk about fake news and we talk about real news, and I think the next thing we're going to see is designer news.
Yeah.
Where you only get the news that's suited for your. But is that real news? Isn't designer news the next thing that's going to be? Because they'll design my Facebook on me. I see one Netflix film, one Netflix thing, and it's on my Facebook.
Yeah, it is. Mm-hmm.
Okay? What if they design my news to suit me? That's not...
I have a recommendation. Get off Facebook.
It's just news. I mean, just if you're going to go digitally on news, how do you know it won't end up being a designer news?
Yeah. Well,
you know, it already is. That's what Fox is.
And that is the future. We are faced with more and more AI, you know, and that's not going to change. I mean, we're going to have, you know, people are already using Echo and Alexa in their homes, right? And asking Alexa questions and getting their news from Alexa, and a lot of local news organizations aren't on Alexa yet, you know, so our news and information is going to be increasingly shaped by Google and Facebook, and, you know, I mean, they've brought their good things, of course, about those platforms, but they don't necessarily have public interest in mind. They're interested in making money. That's their primary interest, and people forget that.
Another problem is the politics and grievance.
And the politics of greed.
And grievance. Yeah. You know, people are. And Trump has made it in greed, not greed, in some limbo, but the whole idea that everybody complains and nobody understands them and such.
That's true.
But it's also worth to get out and try to talk to some people about different views, which is something we're starting to do. Some very nice people out there who can't comment on them, but who are terrific.
Can we take one more question? This woman back here.
Oh, no. Very
and I'm about to explode.
Oh, no.
Let's cut it off.
Stop the rest of it.
One thing, I'm very happy to meet the editor of the Valley News. If I could afford two local newspapers, you know, my Herald and you, I would. So I have my sister in Orford send me all the articles that she knows I'd be interested in. But I love the fact that you put in emotion, human interest in a lot of stories. And I think that has to be done by newspapers. If we're going to attract anybody back off this bloody internet, it's going to be using the emotional quotient, which is what everybody goes to realistically, way before their rational thought breaks in, to a story. I am hollering all by myself in my old dinosaur age about getting critical thinking back into the schools. You know, get a good course that is worthy of at least my time on civics, government, citizenship, critical thinking, debates, things like that. I don't think the kids are getting any of that. And they're getting swept up into this isolationist internet, which to me is ruining the human race very quickly, which also allows in such as a monster like Donald Trump. And it's either fight him or just give it up and assume that, you know, little bitty tweet things are going to take over our conversation. That's all I'll say.
Excellent.
Well, thank you all for coming. It was the start of what could be a long and fruitful discussion. I appreciate all of you for lending your time and expertise. It was great to have you. And have a good evening.